Okay, everyone, why don't we get started? Welcome to what is the final talk of the semester in the International Law Speaker Series sponsored by the Wayne Program for International Legal Studies. My name is Greg Fox. I'm the director of the program, and it's a real pleasure to welcome Lyle Sadat from Washington University in St. Louis as our speaker today. Before I introduce Lyle, you may have noticed that there was a table without food out there. The food is, for some of you, the most critical thing about this talk, maybe food. It is being set up now. There was a little bit of a snafu. What I'd like to ask people to do is if you could go out in small groups and take as much as you like and come back so we don't have the entire audience leaving while Lyle is talking. I'll let you know when it's ready to go, and that way, at least she's talking to somebody for the entire time. This is improvisation on the fly. Lyle Sadat is, I think literally there is no other person in the world who is more qualified to address this topic than Lyle Sadat. Lyle is the director of the Whitney R. Harris World Law Institute at Washington University, where she is also the Henry H. Obershep Professor. She is the director of the Crimes Against Humanity Initiative, which she, I think, will be describing in more detail in her talk. And beyond her positions at Washington University, she is also a special advisor on crimes against humanity to the prosecutor of the International Criminal Court, and is therefore not, you know, only or even principally involved in these issues as an academic matter, but is actually involved with one of the central institutions that would give effect to the principles that she's working on. Lyle is also has been a commissioner of the United States Commission on International Religious Freedom. There's so many other things that I could say about her, and it was just kind of fun reading her resume, finding out that in addition to clerking on the Fifth Circuit in the United States, she also clerked in France on the Cour de Cassation and the Conseil d'État. I don't know how you manage that, but that's really interesting. Having four times won either the Outstanding Book or Outstanding Article of the Year Award from the International Association of Penal Law, having finished first in your class at Tulane Law School, being the author of one of the leading casebooks, or co-author of one of the leading casebooks on international criminal law. I could go on, but as you can tell, this is somebody who is worth listening to. So do we have food?
It should be another minute.
Oh, another minute. Okay. Sorry about that. Well, it's a great pleasure to welcome Lyle Sadat to Wayne Law School.
Thank you so much, Greg, for that very kind introduction. I wish my 13-year-old was listening, because I don't think she thinks I'm worth listening to. That's all right. We all have our tasks, our difficult tasks in life. It's a great pleasure to be back at Wayne. I've been here a couple times before. This is a great law school with great faculty. I see Brad there, also one of my colleagues in international law. And it's an honor to be here to talk to you about a project that is very near and dear to my heart, the effort to establish, adopt, negotiate, create the world's first ever convention on crimes against humanity. So without further ado, I will say I encourage you to go out, get your lunch, and come back. But some of what I'm going to talk about is a little hard. Some of the photos are a little upsetting. And so to the extent that your appetite might be disturbed, I'm sorry, but this is a difficult topic with some very difficult imagery and understanding because of the nature of the subject matter. So in 2008, I started something called the Crimes Against Humanity Initiative. And I can't see the screen very well, so I have to look a little bit behind me. And basically, it was on the premise that the world didn't finish the Nuremberg legacy, that there remained an important gap because crimes against humanity remained significant as a phenomenon throughout the world, and that something could be done about the gap. It's okay. I've got this pretty memorized. And something could be done about the gap. And I endeavored to think about doing it, actually, myself with the Institute. Crimes Against Humanity develops as a legal concept, first from rhetoric and language in the preambular paragraphs of the Hague Conventions of 1899 and 1907. And there was this little provision called the Martin's Clause after the Russian jurist who had advanced it, that in the until a more complete code of the laws of war has been established, the individuals, that is citizens, civilians, humanity remains under the protections of the principles of the law of nations as results from the usages established, and you can see this language, among civilized people from the laws of humanity and the dictates of the public conscience. And the idea was that customary international law, that is unwritten international law that bound all nations, contained rules that even if they weren't in the codifications on the law of war, nonetheless could protect individuals. That is, there was this idea that outside the four corners of the treaties that were being adopted and sort of the very early efforts to codify the laws of war, there were these principles that protected human beings as well. At Nuremberg, the rhetoric in the Martin's Clause becomes positive law when the Nuremberg Charter incorporates, for the first time in history, this new category of crime called crimes against humanity. And this picture is Justice Robert Jackson, who's the chief prosecutor for the United States at Nuremberg, pleading the case. Actually, the United States was more convinced with the more concerned with the aggressive war charges. It was the French and the Russians who, for the most part, presented the crimes against humanity charges at Nuremberg. But crimes against humanity was a very central feature of the prosecutions during World War II and is codified then for the very first time, we see, in Article 6C. And it incorporated these murder-type crimes as well as persecution-type crimes. And, of course, the persecutions were referring to the attempt to exterminate Europe's Jews.
Lunch is ready, sorry, commercial break. If you would like to go in small groups and come back, you can start the process.
Maybe from the back row, start in the back row, sort of like reverse communion or something.
Sorry.
Back row can go get your food, and then we'll go to the front. So after World War II, right, there's this huge enthusiasm. The United Nations is established, as we know. We have the San Francisco Conference. We have the creation of a new international institution that has as its raison d'être, if you like, the prevention and the stopping of war, as well as the protection of human rights and the promotion of economic development and peace among peoples. So there's a huge codification effort after World War II, which includes the establishment of the Genocide Convention, the Torture Convention, the Enforced Disappearances Convention, the Apartheid Convention, but we never see a Crimes Against Humanity treaty. We see treaties on the laws of war, the 1949 Geneva Conventions and their two protocols in 1977. We see broad codification of human rights, but we never get a convention on crimes against humanity. We can talk about why that might be so after the war. We do get the Genocide Convention, right? So in a sense, the Genocide Convention is a codification of what the Nazis tried to do to European Jewry, which was the attempted destruction in whole or in part of a religious group, which they define as a racial group, right? And so Article 2 of the Convention says any of the following acts, and it lists a series of acts, including murder and other acts, committed with the intent to destroy a national, ethnic, racial, or religious group, constitutes the crime of genocide. In a sense, this is a monument. It's a codification of the Holocaust. But what happens when you get a new genocide, arguably the worst in terms of percentage of population killed in the 20th century, and it happens in Cambodia? Well, you have about 2 million of a country with 7 million people exterminated by the Khmer Rouge regime. But is it genocide? Gareth Evans and all other legal experts pretty much agree that this was not genocide, because the ambition of the Khmer Rouge was to kill people because of social class or political group, not because of their race, religion, nationality, or ethnic origin. And so arguably the worst genocide in history, genocide convention, simply doesn't apply. You also have cases in which crimes against humanity are occurring. Bosnian War in the 1990s. And in Bosnia versus Serbia, Bosnia brought a case under the Genocide Convention to the International Court of Justice and says, look, we are the subject, our people were the subject of an attempted extermination. 200,000 people are killed, 50,000 rapes, displacements in the hundreds of thousands. And the International Court of Justice shrugs and says, look, genocide may have happened in Srebrenica, but the rest of it's ethnic cleansing, it's crimes against humanity, and we have no jurisdiction over crimes against humanity because there is no treaty. The compromissory clause in the Genocide Convention is the basis of the court's jurisdiction. So we have a legal gap. We have a sociological gap. And if one looks at the last 300-odd armed conflicts around the world, we see a death toll of 90 to 100 million people killed, most of whom are civilians. And this doesn't include other crimes. So one thinks about murder, right, when one thinks about crimes against humanity, but it covers lots of different human rights abuses, such as sexual slavery, enforced disappearance, apartheid, torture. And you can see around the world, you have an impunity gap because of all those crimes committed, maybe 1% of the perpetrators have been brought to justice. And this slide shows some of the more famous individuals, some of whom are listed in Professor Rath's course that he's going to promote, I think, later. Slobodan Milosevic, Deutsch from the Cambodia Tribunal, accused and convicted of crimes against humanity. Milosevic had been accused of genocide. He died before that trial was ever finished. So we have significant what we call an impunity gap, that is, between those who arguably ordered or committed the crimes and those who've been brought to justice. So in the 1990s, following the fall of the Berlin Wall in 1989 and the breakup of the former Yugoslavia, which gives rise to these atrocities that I just referred to, and the Rwandan genocide in 1994, we have a resurgence of interest in the Nuremberg legacy, and several international ad hoc criminal tribunals are created. Yugoslavia Tribunal, the Rwanda Tribunal, the Special Court for Sierra Leone, right? The Khmer Rouge Tribunal, which is the last one you see there, and the special panels in East Timor. And each of these courts has crimes against humanity in its statute as something that it can prosecute. And the definition is different in every one of the five statutes because, of course, we don't have any treaty-based definition of crimes against humanity. We finally get one here. In 1998, 120 states voted to accept, to establish the new International Criminal Court. And there had been preparatory meetings prior to 1998 during which states started to negotiate what could a definition of crimes against humanity look like, among many other provisions. And in 1998, you had 165 states that came to Rome. You had 250 NGOs that came to Rome. I felt very lucky I got to go to Rome because it was an extraordinary experience participating in these negotiations, even as a non-governmental organization delegate. And they voted to adopt the Rome Statute for the International Criminal Court, Article 7 of which has the definition of crimes against humanity. So we've done it, right? We can stop. Well, not so fast. There's still gaps, because the Rome Statute system is premised on a vertical system of enforcement. That is, you have a supranational court, essentially, that can prosecute individuals, but you still don't have mechanisms for states to cooperate with each other. The Rome Statute also doesn't provide for state responsibility. You can see I've listed, it doesn't bind non-states parties. Is that important? Well, it's really important if you're an American, because the United States is not a state party. In fact, even though the Rome Statute probably covers 3.3 billion people, that would leave 4.6 billion not yet covered, because some major players, China, India, the United States, Russia, are not yet Rome Statute state parties. Lots of small countries too, not just major players. So gaps in the Rome Statute system, both legal and practical, are significant. So in 2008, I started this effort, and I have to pay homage here to Sharif Bassiouni, who had written a little article in 1994 saying, why don't we have a specialized convention on crimes against humanity? And nobody really paid attention to Professor Bassoni at the time. We were all working on the International Criminal Court Statute. But of course, as always, he was somebody ahead of his time. I'll talk about this picture in a moment. So I came up with this idea that we would have a project, and we would call it this initiative, and it would proceed in four phases. And essentially, we would start just with the steering committee organizing it. Then we would go to private discussions and commissioning papers to see whether it was practical. Then we would reach out to international experts to get commentary on our work. And finally, we would go public with promotion. So this has been taken, well, it's been about 6 years now. So on your left is, is Whitney Harris. I'm very lucky to be the director of the Harris World Law Institute. It's named for this gentleman here, who's the last, living member of Justice Jackson's team at Nuremberg. And Whitney actually spoke at our first conference on the creation. He was very supportive. So we came up with this preparation. And in winter 2008, I convened the steering committee, and we started to plan how we would work. In April 2009, we brought a good, and these are pictures some of you who are international law folks will recognize, many of the individuals on these slides. We brought a group of individuals to St. Louis, Missouri to have an experts meeting. We commissioned papers that are now published in this excellent book that's here. And we discussed the papers. And it was very stressful. Nobody had ever started doing this before. And there was a lot of controversy. Could we do it? How would we do it? What would it look like? We then revised a draft that Professor Bassoni had circulated. We had a technical session. And in June, we had our second conference where we went to The Hague. See, many of these photos are from The Hague with different individuals. Larry Johnson, Assistant Secretary General. You can see Chris Hall from Amnesty International, judges from the International Criminal Court. You get a really good group in The Hague because so many practitioners of international criminal justice are there. So we again revised the convention, and this time we brought a small group to St. Louis. We ripped the draft apart at the seams. We put it back together based on the input we'd had from the two meetings. And we then sent out the draft in English and French to about 100 experts around the world for comment. We collected their comment, and we held our final meeting in March 2010. I say final, but we just had a meeting last summer, so I guess this will never be done until it's done. But we had what we considered our capstone conference in March 2010 at the Brookings Institution, which is a partner institution of Washington University. You can see Judge Ed Sirico, Monica Weinberg, two individuals from the International Criminal Court on your right, Gilbert Petit and Mohamed Al-Zaidi, Mary Wirtz, the U.S. delegate for the ICRC. We really brought together the top talent. And again, got a lot of really good commentary on we like this, we don't like this. But what was really exciting was this idea that had been met with a certain degree of skepticism starting to get some traction. And by the Brookings meeting, we issued something called the Washington Declaration, saying that there should be a new convention on crimes against humanity, and it should have certain basic features. And this was signed by 75 individuals. We then revised the convention one more time. We published it. We re-put it out in French again. And we then published this book after the papers were revised and moved into what we now call phase four. So phase four is about promotion of the convention and getting this out into the world. And I can talk about that because it was difficult. Obviously, state governments aren't so keen necessarily to sign up to a treaty like this because crimes against humanity in its initial conceptualization is about what a state is doing to its own citizens. So it's pretty radical stuff. Now we understand that it applies to non-state actors too. States like that part of it. So I think it has more legs. But we were very fortunate when one of the individuals who came to the Brookings meeting was Sean Murphy, who's a professor at GW Law School and a good friend. And Sean really liked our project. And then Professor Murphy is elected a U.S. member of the International Law Commission. And he decides that his contribution as an ILC member is going to get our convention into the ILC and start drafting articles. And the International Law Convention is the official treaty, sort of preparatory body of the United Nations. It did the initial draft of the International Criminal Court statute. So that was very fortunate. And Professor Murphy then invited our group last summer to go to Geneva and to convene a meeting with the members of the International Law Commission to try to get them to move this from their long-term agenda. So he managed to get it on the long-term agenda, but what we really wanted was to get it on the active agenda so we could get draft articles, a treaty conference, and get moving. And this is just a little bit of history, especially for me, sometimes the historic nature of this whole thing is a little overwhelming. So we managed to partner with the Geneva Academy, and we held our meeting at the Villa Magnier. And for those of you who are students of history, the Villa Magnier was the residence of Gustave Magnier, who was the principal of FOUNS, right? FOUNS, the International Committee of the Red Cross. And it was where the 1864 Geneva Convention, which was the first Geneva Convention, was negotiated. And that's where we held our meeting. So we kind of had chills that we could go to this beautiful villa in Geneva and try to convince the members of the International Law Commission to take this project forward. So I have a couple slides now. What's in the proposed convention? The proposed convention, for those of you who are students of international law, if you've read the Rome Statute from the International Criminal Court, and you've read the Torture Convention, and you've read the UN Convention on Organized Crime, and maybe one of the terrorism treaties, you will see this looks a bit like a mélange of all of them. Because what we had the benefit of, right, was we could look at all the corpus of existing instruments and say, what would an ideal treaty look like? So we have a preambular provision that has very similar language to the Rome Statute, right, which is that this has shocked humanity. The millions dead, disappeared, enslaved, etc. And then we have Article 1. Article 1 is so simple. Crimes against humanity, whether committed in time of armed conflict or in time of peace, constitute crimes under international law for which there is individual criminal responsibility. In addition, states may be held responsible for crimes against humanity pursuant to principles of state responsibility for international wrongful act. This is the core, two obligations. States can't commit them. Individuals can commit them, right? And presumably this is non-state actors as well. The proposed convention has 27 articles. It has 6 annexes. We did strive for simplicity because one of the things that Professor Fox and I were talking about, the Genocide Convention is so beautiful because it's so simple. It also makes it very non-useful as a legal instrument, but the general public can read it and say, I get it. This is what genocide is. And so we took much of the technical stuff in this convention and we put it in annexes so you can see Article 1's simplicity. You can see how the provisions are understandable and recognizable. It provides a horizontal mechanism and it completes the Rome Statute system by taking as its central definition of crimes against humanity the Rome Statute definition of crimes against humanity. And I can come back to why we made that choice because there are criticisms of the Rome Statute. We also said that any new convention has to focus on deterrence and prevention and has to focus as well on capacity building because so many times this happens in states that are impoverished one way or another. This is a list of the kinds of things that our treaty does, any new treaty can do. It has an out debtor ad judicare obligation. It abolishes immunities and statutes of limitations. It provides no superior orders defense, which was at Nuremberg. Commanders are responsible for crimes against humanity committed by their troops. It also has an important and interesting provision on the liability of legal persons. If a state prosecutes legal persons as companies, right, for the commission of crimes, then we argue they should include crimes against humanity in the list of crimes that they're prosecuting companies for. Not every state does this, so for some states that's not going to be relevant, but for the Netherlands, for France, for liability of legal persons is common, then we argue crimes against humanity should be the same kind of provision. You can also see that it has a provision on prohibition of hate crimes and incitement, which is new. If these are the provisions, reparations, human rights provisions are very important, and those are new. You don't see those in the Genocide Convention because they're newer ideas, but the idea that victims might be entitled to reparations We propose a tree monitoring body, like the torture committee or the human rights committee. That could be adjusted or modified during our Geneva conference. We had Jean-Marie Henkertz, who's the legal advisor to the ICRC, who said, why don't you look at the treaty bodies for cluster bombs convention or for some of the other war crimes conventions? So that, I thought, was very interesting. And we have lots of technical stuff about transferring individuals to states so that a state can't be a safe haven. You know, one interesting statistic we just ran across in our research is the Department of Homeland Security says there are 1,000 individuals now living in the United States who they believe to be guilty of crimes against humanity, who they can't deport, and they can't prosecute. Right? That's pretty astonishing. So the idea is that you have legislation and you have a treaty mechanism that allows you to either to, you know, extradite or prosecute, which is the core obligation of the convention. Here are a few more things. We put in the idea of the voluntary trust fund, again, as part of the capacity building and prevention dimension of the convention. So now we are basically working with the International Law Commission. We are trying to build a constituency, so I'll be in New York at the Assembly of States Parties for the ICC, giving a talk in December. I've done that before. I meet with foreign ministers and individuals from governments trying to persuade them that this is a good idea. Fortunately, the International Law Commission has now taken up that banner, so it's a lot easier to persuade them because now it's real, it's on the table, it's being negotiated. And the ILC just presented its report to the Sixth Committee, and the Sixth Committee was overall very positive, as were the human rights organizations. One of the things we've been doing as an academic institution is translating the convention, which is harder than it seems. So French and Spanish are quite easy because you can use other treaties, texts, and make sure, for example, you're tracking. We took Article 7 of the Rome Statute, so that exists in French and Spanish. And so we can just use those definitions. But it turns out there are lots of mistakes in the Arabic, Chinese, and Russian versions of a lot of existing treaties. So we ran into some surprising difficulties where we would take the existing treaty language and then our native speakers, our native Chinese, Arabic, or Russian speakers would say, that's horrible, that's terrible, that doesn't even make sense. So there you have it. Little technical things. This takes hours and hours and hours, I can tell you. It got translated into German because a German professor really liked the idea, and he was so enthusiastic, he said, I need this in German so that when the Bundestag comes to ratify this treaty one day, we will have it in German. So he did it for us for free. Last little note of history, the idea that some of this could come out of a small Midwestern law school, right? This could resonate here at Wayne State, small Midwestern law schools coming up with big ideas or big projects. I have to share with you a little bit about this photo. So in 1904, when St. Louis was a major city, and maybe Detroit residents will appreciate, sort of, you can be a declining city for centuries, as it turns out. So St. Louis was a major city in 1904, and the World's Fair was held there. And the Interparliamentary Union met in Ridgely Hall, which is on the Washington University campus, and this photo was taken. And they actually adopted the resolution that was sent to President Roosevelt to call the Second Hague Peace Conference. Came right from Washington University campus. And so we did a photo op with my steering committee. And I guess I didn't explain. I will explain a little bit about my steering committee. You can see, I think I shortened my presentation. So on the left, the woman in front, Christine Van den Minger, is a Belgian national. She's a judge at the International Criminal Court. You can see Professor Sharif Bassiouni sitting sort of right behind her. Richard Goldstone sitting in the front next to them. He was the first chief prosecutor of the ICTY, ICTR. He's South African. Then we have Bill Chavis, who's Canadian, but was director of the Irish Center for Human Rights, and he really wrote the pivotal work on the Genocide Convention, so it was important to have him here, and he's written the treatise on the ICC as well. Ben May, obviously, still wearing the same jacket. So, and Hans Corell, former Undersecretary General of the United Nations for Legal Affairs, and Hans was very much important and central to this because he was the most skeptical member of my steering committee, but also had personally participated as Kofi Annan's representative at the Rome Conference for the International Criminal Court. So in a sense, he represents the negotiation of that treaty. And finally, Juan Mendez from Argentina, who has been both a special rapporteur on genocide and a special rapporteur on torture, and former president of the International Center for Transitional Justice. So we really had the seven of us working together to kind of manage this project over the past, you know, 6 years. And it's been a tremendous honor for me to work with those individuals. So I think I'll stop here. You can read all about it either in our excellent book or in our website. And the treaties are actually available for free. You can just go to the website and click on them in your language of choice. So I think, Greg, I'll stop there and maybe take questions. And anybody who didn't grab their lunch, please go ahead and do so. Thank you.
Thank you, Lila. I hope you don't mind if I take the privilege and ask you one big picture question and then one very specific question. For those who might not be familiar with this area of international law, could you explain the relationship between your proposed treaty and the ICC? Do they complement each other? Are there potential areas of conflict? Because I think that a lot of people here might not understand that relationship. Then they've got a really small board question. Concerns the inclusion of an obligation regarding hate speech. And when you combine that with the no reservations policy, does that pose a problem in the United States? Because as you know, the U.S. has a reservation with the hate speech provision. Would that be a deal breaker for the U.S.? I suspect not, but I'm interested in that.
Oh, great questions. So what is the relationship of a new convention on crimes against humanity to the ICC? And honestly, this question was the first and foremost question that everybody asked when we started the project. Because I'm American and because the United States, there was a political dimension and a legal dimension. So let me talk about the politics because maybe that's actually even more interesting. The politics is that the United States is not a state party to the ICC, but I'm American, right? And more than that, the United States was actively opposed to the ICC during the first tenure of Bush 43 and attacked the court, literally, you know, attacked the court in various ways. And so there was a concern among many individuals who one initially would think, hey, a new convention on crimes against humanity, promote human rights, yes. And then they think, oh, but is this a stealth attack on the International Criminal Court? Is this a way of siphoning off support for the ICC? Is this a way of putting a band-aid over the fact that some of the major non-states parties don't want to ratify, et cetera? And as a legal matter, the initial question was, would we redefine crimes against humanity? That could have been a huge mess because you could have had this new multilateral convention presuming to have a universal definition of crimes against humanity that had something different than the International Criminal Court statute. So you had both the political dimension of, was this really a stealth attack on the International Criminal Court, especially coming from the fact that I'm American. I may have an unusual American name, but I'm still American. And that there was this bad history, right, with the United States and the ICC. In terms of the politics and the legal question, it became clear that the only, and this is a very interesting legal issue, we decided there were two ways we could define crimes against humanity in a new convention. We quickly decided in St. Louis at that first meeting we could not have a different definition. We had the top scholars in the world, Kayambos, other people saying, you need to get rid of the civilian population requirement, get rid of the policy element, etc. And we finally, after long and very heated debate, said, we can't do that. You cannot have this new convention come up as an opposition, right? You can't try to fix things you don't like in the ICC definition because you're going to be creating two regimes. It's incoherent. How will a state that's ratified the ICC then implement its legislative right requirements? It doesn't make sense. And it would be seen politically as an attack on the court. So we quickly came up with the idea that we could vary or deviate from the ICC definition, not one comma, right? Not one comma. And interestingly, the ILC has taken the same position. They have taken exactly the same position. We have a definition. We have 122 ICC state parties now. That definition is going to be the core definition. But that didn't completely solve the question of was this still a stealth attack on the ICC, because we have the ICC. And what's interesting to me, the ICC casts a shadow that's very long. but it's a teeny tiny institution. It has very, very limited jurisdiction. It can only take cases, right, where a state has actually either referred the case or it's an ICC state party and all the other jurisdictional requirements are met, including complementarity and admissibility and every other requirement. So there are very few cases jurisdictionally that can hear. And then it can only handle a few perpetrators. Why? Think about the size of this court. Its budget around 110 million euros. Guess what? That's the same budget that the ICTY had just to cover Yugoslavia, and the ICC is supposed to cover the entire world. And so I won't say that the states parties have created a Potemkin tribunal. There are those who say this court is powerless. I don't think it's powerless. I work for the prosecutor. I'm a big supporter of this court. But I do think that the court is much more fragile. It's much smaller than it needs to be, even to prosecute the major perpetrators out of the conflicts that are on its docket. Right? So that leaves the impunity gap problem. The other thing, as I mentioned, is the ICC statute doesn't apply to non-states parties, except if the Security Council agrees. And we've seen in a serious situation an egregious abuse, in my view, of the veto by two permanent members of the Security Council refusing to refer Syria to the International Criminal Court. So we need national courts. The other reason we need national courts to be prosecuting is they're actually the best able to do so. All criminal law experts will tell you better to try a case in a national court where you have well-established rules of evidence, presumably you have well-trained prosecutors, et cetera. Now, for these specialized crimes, we do now suggest, and this is part of the capacity building, that there be teams who are well-equipped and schooled in the law and complexity of mass atrocity cases who can handle these kind of criminal law cases. But national courts are the most powerful enforcers of the criminal law. And so we want to empower national courts to do the job, right? And they can't do that now. There's some really interesting examples, as I mentioned. 1,000 people living in the United States who can't be prosecuted, can't be extradited. Pol Pot, when he resurfaced in Cambodia, Cambodians really couldn't try him. There were Khmer Rouge still in the government, and they searched around desperately to find a state that would be able to do it, and states couldn't do it because crimes against humanity, it wasn't genocide, and crimes against humanity didn't have a treaty. There was no outward obligation to try and extradite with other states, and they didn't have legislation. So that's really, this is about shoring up and completing the ICC statute system. This is not about detracting from the court. And I think it's finally getting through that the folks supporting this aren't trying to attack the court. We're trying to help the court in the common goal of preventing impunity. Now, on hate speech and incitement and reservations, sorry, this is a long-winded answer. So, the Genocide Convention has a provision on incitement. And when the Rome Statute was negotiated, they tried to put incitement to crimes against humanity into crimes against humanity in Article 7, and the drafters said, no, it's not part of customary international law, we have to be conservative. I think we can put it in without affecting Article 7 as a mode of liability. Why would you want it? Because crimes against humanity now, it's not genocide like it was in World War II. These are widespread or systematic human rights abuses, typically preceded by hate speech and propaganda, and inciting propaganda. And so if you look at the Rwanda conflict, for example, and you look at the magazines that were published, Kangura, which was referring to the Tutsi as cockroaches and whipping up the hate speech, individuals that worked in the ICTR, that worked in the Rwanda conflict, say, propaganda was some of the worst part of it. That was true in World War II as well. There were two individuals convicted based on their propaganda against Jews at Nuremberg. So the hate speech and incitement is really important, and it's in the ICCPR. Now, our government's going to take that out. It's in our convention. Will they put it in? I think it's really important if you care about prevention and deterrence, because it really does allow you to get at conduct that sometimes even proceeds because it can be a inchoate crime, the commission of the actual murders. But it is a question. Now, we put no reservations in. So reservations for the international law students, you know, they allow a state to accept the legal obligations of a treaty, but to reserve out. Why do we put no reservations? States hate that. States want to pick and choose. Oh, okay, I like Article 3, but I hate Article 7. So I'm going to sign on to Articles 5 and 6, and, you know, especially the U.S. Senate really loves to do this. So why no reservations? We knew that that would be maybe the first provision that states took out of our draft convention if they used it as a model. The Rome Statute has no reservations. We did have earlier drafts where we tried to find articles saying, okay, states can't reserve out of these articles, but you can reserve out of these articles. And it became clear that that didn't work very well either, because the 27 articles are all really important. I mean, I guess you can reserve out of the Treaty Monitoring Body or something. But it was very hard to say which of the provisions of the treaty are core obligations, where if you take them away, you really undermine the statute. And which of the provisions, okay, we don't really care that much about them. So we put in no reservations. We tracked the ICC statute in that. It was maybe more important in the ICC statute context, because the idea was you're going to have a uniform regime, all the states are signing on to it, no opting in or out, we're just all bound by the ICC statute. But I think, my guess is states will take it out. But as the academics and practitioners who were directing the project, we had this tension between, we wanted to do something that was politically acceptable in the sense that it was realistic. States could look at this and say, oh, this is a bunch of NGO nonsense, right? We didn't want to look ridiculous. Well, we're also the ones who are the human rights protective people, right? So we didn't want to give away ab initio lots of things that we actually thought would make it a stronger, more effective convention. And so that was a very delicate balance during the drafting, and something I'm sure that states will reopen immediately once they get started.
Great.
Yeah. Other questions?
Yes, I think we have a microphone in the back, so if you have a question, you can bring the microphone to this gentleman in the front.
I can speak loudly. Does the proposal override diplomatic immunity? And if it does override it, then arrest of someone with diplomatic immunity would be an act of war.
Wait, say the second half, because I heard, does it override diplomatic immunity?
Because if you arrest someone who has diplomatic immunity, that itself would be an act of war. So instead of making the world more peaceful, which is your intent, that would lead to more war.
So one of the things that was difficult at Nuremberg, great question, was the Allies, the four Allied powers, wanted to prosecute the German leadership. And that diplomatic immunity was a problem, right? Because they wanted to prosecute the head of state, who was Dönitz at the time, because Hitler had committed suicide. And a head of state under international law has immunity. Not just diplomatic immunity, right? I mean, it was thought complete immunity of their person. They didn't have to be on a diplomatic mission to have immunity. After World War I, there were attempts to prosecute the German Kaiser. And the United States raised exactly these objections. They dissented. And in fact, he was Queen Victoria's grandson. And so he stayed in the Netherlands, and the guards never really turned him over. Right? Even though he was arguably indicted, because everybody felt that there was this immunity, that heads of state, high government officials could be immune, and that it would, in fact, foment war. It was the second war, right, where individuals who normally would adhere to principles of diplomatic immunity said, no, enough is enough is enough, ordering these category of crimes, right, what we call genocide now, crimes against humanity, war crimes, serious war crimes, and the waging of an aggressive war, these strip the individuals who order them or commit them of their immunity. So it is a radical proposition, right? It is an exception to the rule. The Torture Convention has the same thing. And ironically, torture is an official act. Torture, by its definition, is the acts prohibited in the Torture Convention committed by a government official. And the convention also says no immunity. The Genocide Convention says the same thing. Now, there have been recent pushbacks against this. African heads of state state haven't liked that Bashir has been indicted by the International Criminal Court. He's the sitting head of state of Sudan. It's not so much fomenting war, but there is a pushback, and he did expel all the humanitarian aid workers from Sudan when the indictment came out. But it is a principle of international criminal law, in my view, that those who commit the most serious crimes, right, these are crimes that threaten the peace and security of the world, crimes against humanity, war crimes, and genocide, are not immune from prosecution. Now, that's not necessarily true for interstate prosecutions, right? That's international prosecutions. For interstate prosecutions, the International Court of Justice has said during their tenure in office, a head of state, and then we know a foreign minister, right, after the Herodian case, they are immune. They can't be prosecuted in a different state. They can be prosecuted in their own state. But after they leave office, which of course is the concern of heads of state, after they leave office, the court suggested they could be prosecuted, although the language of the court is very strange because it talks about acts in their private capacity, etc. I think the better rule, and the ILC is working on these same issues, and many are worried the ILC draft rules will be conservative. The better rule is that after they leave office, they can be prosecuted for acts that were international crimes recognized under international law, etc., etc. And that's another reason why you need a codification of crimes against humanity. You need the international community to agree on this, not just in the Rome Statute to be prosecuted internationally, but that individuals cannot travel from state to state. The Hussein Habre case, he's being tried in Senegal now for crimes committed in Chad, right? Better to have Pinochet tried in Chile than in the UK or Spain, but the Pinochet case also opened that up as well, that after you leave office, you are no longer necessarily protected if you committed international crimes while you were in office, even for prosecution before other states. So yes, it is a pretty radical change from classic notions, and those notions die hard, and we are seeing a pushback from the African Union states. We are seeing a little pushback at the ILC, and this is the context in which this new convention will be negotiated, right, is we have to take into account the pushback. So it will be a very interesting conversation between government leaders and members of civil society, because the human rights organizations are firm that no immunity for the commission of international crimes. So, great question. Thank you. Yeah. And came back.
You referred to the possible prosecution of Pol Pot, and can you cite other historical examples where the proposal might have made a difference?
Oh, that's a really good question. I can tell you right now, as I said, we have 1,000 people living in the United States, according to the Department of Homeland Security, that we can't prosecute and we can't deport, who are alleged to have committed crimes against humanity. A historic example that I started writing about when I first got involved in crimes against humanity work was Klaus Barbie, who was a German who was known as the Butcher of Lyon. He had been based in Lyon during the Second World War. And the French had, there were rumors, not only that Barbie and others were around, but there were even rumors that Hitler was alive and he was in hiding. And so the French Senate in the 1960s decided that these individuals had all committed crimes against humanity, and if they surfaced, they wanted to be able to prosecute them, right? And the problem was the statute of limitations had run, because many countries have statutes of limitations on war crimes. They have statute of limitations on murder, which is essentially what you'd be trying if you didn't have specialized legislation on crimes against humanity. So France could not have tried, even had Hitler resurfaced, right? Germany's statute of limitations was on the verge of expiring, and France could not have tried crimes against humanity. So France actually was one of the first countries to incorporate crimes against humanity into its national legislation, and that was the basis on which Klaus Barbie was ultimately, he was kidnapped. Really, and brought to France, and he was tried for crimes against humanity for what he had done during the war. But you have lots of cases like that where you have these strange procedural obstacles to a retroactive, that is a prosecution that might take place a decade after the crimes had occurred. You have this going on right now in Argentina. Argentina had many crimes committed during the junta in the 1970s, and the Argentinian courts actually removed the amnesties and the statute of limitations through jurisprudence. right? So you do have states that either adopt legislation on their own, or their courts work to get rid of the kinds of procedural obstacles to prosecutions, but it's generally agreed that mostly you need an international treaty framework with an agreed definition, and then provisions that allow states to cooperate with each other, and then agree that these are universal crimes, that universal jurisdiction applies, and that individuals can go. Does that answer your question? I don't know if I was really responsive, but.
It was, thank you.
Yeah, there's another question. Hi.
I was wondering, do you have an opinion on whether or not a codified system of international laws about crimes against humanity, if that would possibly interfere with some states choosing to go about healing from certain conflicts in a non-criminal, non-tribunal sort of way? I mean, referring to like truth commissions in South Africa. Do you think that there's a conflict there?
So that's another great question, right? So there was, and there still is, this debate, do we want peace, do we want justice, right? Do criminal trials inflame situations and rather than restore peace and healing to situations? My general answer is, well, it's a complicated question. First of all, nothing in this draft, right, nothing in this project prevents a state from creating a truth commission. And we have seen in almost every state in which atrocities have taken place, both truth commissions and prosecutions, including South Africa. There were 1,500 prosecutions in South Africa. Many people feel there should have been more prosecutions in South Africa. It's not clear that the South African process worked as well at healing, but it certainly avoided the bloodbath that had been talked about. I remember I was involved in sort of the civil society movement to try to end apartheid. And everybody talked about a bloodbath that would take place once the apartheid restrictions were lifted, and that never happened, which was extraordinary. During the Rome Statute negotiation, this issue came up, and Article 53 of the Rome Statute allows the prosecutor not to go forward, quote, if it's in the interests of justice, end quotes. What is that language there? Most people feel it's an allusion to the South African process. That is, states can design their own custom-tailored process to deal with transitional justice mechanisms. Rwanda has the gachacha. But Rwanda also, right, there are many Rwandans who have gone to the ICTR, which adjudicated, I think, 90 cases, right, cases against 90 individuals, some of whom were acquitted. So I think, looking at this, most people feel you need both the criminal prosecution and then the processes that restore healing. And they vary tremendously from country to country, their culture and situation specific, and they take a long time to work, right? We know they take a long time to work. The idea behind the prosecutions is that victims want justice. And I've seen this in every country I've studied in depth. I haven't obviously studied all 193 countries of the world, but I started my research in France. Mitterrand was the first one to say, we cannot have trials of Frenchmen for crimes against humanity. Our crimes against humanity law was for Germans. It was for Barbie. It was for Hitler, who they thought was still running around hiding, right? Kind of a crazy idea, but that was the fear. And it was French civil society. It was victims groups who were predominantly Jewish, because so many Jews were deported and killed from French territory. And who was doing the deporting? It was not the Germans, it was the Vichy government, right? That was working in collaboration with Germans to attack, capture, put on trains, and send off to the East French Jews and members of the resistance. And Mitterrand said, this is gonna, you know, we're gonna have a civil war over this, because France had sort of forgotten, right? They didn't wanna talk about the collaboration during the war. There was a purge right after the war, and then people wanted to forget about it. And instead, I think the Tuvier trial, it was the first Frenchman tried. The courts removed the obstacles to his trial. And it was a tremendously healing process, actually, for French civil society. Now, it took place, right, decades after the crimes had been committed. Many of the perpetrators were dead, and it was the victims' children who were bringing the case. But it was interesting to me that those victims' groups had not forgotten what had happened to their parents. They still demanded justice. They still felt that their dad being lined up against the wall and shot because he was Jewish was a crime, and that the Frenchman who ordered it should be prosecuted. And so Touvier was convicted, I want to say, 1995 or 96, and the accident taking place in 1945. So what you see, I think, is that victims want a pretty universal accounting. They want justice. We hear that at the ICC all the time. When I was at the Kampala Review Conference, there were busloads of women from northern Uganda coming down and saying, we want justice. We want the people that burned our village and took our children and captured our husbands. We want them taken away, and we want them tried. So I think, now, you can't try everybody. And not everybody deserves to be tried. And after a civil war, the general rule is you put down your weapons and you make peace, right? So for those ordinary fighting combatants, there's no prosecution of those individuals. It's just the individuals who commit atrocities. And it's the atrocities, right? The rapes, the enslavement, the amputations. It's not just combatants sort of leveling weapons at other combatants. It's the attack on civilians and the total war on civilians, burning villages. I mean, the kind of crimes that are committed in these conflicts are gruesome. So the notion that you're going to sit and sing, you know, I hate to say kumbaya, but right, the notion that you're going to sit and not say, I need something more. The other important addition is reparations. What folks want is their village to be rebuilt, their nose to be reattached or redone, right, the schools to be reformulated. And I think the Victims Trust Fund at the ICC gave us the idea of what about having a fund that can be used both for reparations, where you disgorge the illegal proceeds, right, the ill-gotten gains, and you have to use those proceeds either in service, right, as restitution or as reparations. So, but yeah, I don't think they're mutually exclusive, but a great question.
Is it so you mentioned that the convention contains a horizontal enforcement mechanism. Mm-hmm. So I was wondering which entity has the authority to exercise enforcement powers, and what are the enforcement measures, and do they differ from whatever is permitted in the Genocide Convention? So I don't actually know what horizontal enforcement
great.
Is.
Great, okay,
it,
too
is
much
it other
jargon.
States?
Okay, states. Yeah, too much jargon. Sorry about that. I've been teaching this too long. So we now have in the world maybe 324 international criminal law treaties. They do all kinds of things. They prohibit terrorism, they prohibit torture, they prohibit organized crime, they prohibit corruption, they prohibit war crimes, although those are sort of international humanitarian law treaties, they're not necessarily international criminal law convention. They prohibit torture and apartheid, right? Lots of treaties, over 300 worldwide. And all of those treaties have provisions in them that are addressed to the ministers of justice, really, of states, and to the foreign ministry, saying, if you receive a request for cooperation, because we need to investigate these crimes, please cooperate, right? It goes through diplomatic channels, what the gentleman was referring to. And in Europe, they actually have a European arrest warrant now, which allows for immediate arrest, which doesn't happen anywhere else, right? So in the United States, for example, when our government, when a foreign government comes and says, we believe you have an individual on your territory who's committed a crime in our country. It could be any one of these crimes. It could be terrorism. It could be money laundering. It could be corruption. Please, pursuant to this treaty that your state and our state entered into, please go have your police arrest this individual and please extradite them to our country where they can stand trial. And under this obligation called auxiliary adjudicare, the United States can say, well, it turns out, actually, that we're going to try that person because we actually think we have a stake in this fight. There's no conflicts of jurisdiction provision that says which state gets to do it. And so the United States could try the individual themselves, or the United States could say, great, we will extradite this person to your country, and you will try this person. There are all kinds of rules. But you can imagine, this is harsh. Somebody could be living on a state territory 20 years, and all of a sudden an extradition request comes in. Lots came in from Israel, right? The Netanyahu case, you might have heard of that. Individuals suspected of having been Nazis that are found to be living in the United States or in Bolivia or Argentina, and the Israeli government says, please turn them over to us, and we're going to try them for crimes against the Jewish people, crimes against humanity. But it has to be formal. There has to be a hearing that shows that the state requesting actually has produced enough evidence to, because it's a very harsh remedy. It's deportation for trial, right? You have to show that both states have the same law on the book. So, for example, Mexico has laws on criminal libel. The United States doesn't have criminal libel. Mexico government says, we want that person in a criminal libel case. The United States can say, no, that's not something they can be prosecuted for here. We can't send them to you for prosecution. There are exceptions for political cases, right? There were a lot of tit-for-tat between the United States and Great Britain on IRA members who were thought to be in the United States, where Great Britain asked the United Kingdom ask for extradition, and the U.S. court said, well, this is a political case, right, against a suspected IRA terrorist. So there are lots of rules, and it has to be a very formal process. So that's the interstate process. And without those rules, you just don't have a system. And so you have lots of states that can operate as safe havens for individuals because they're lax laws. And they can go live in those countries, which might turn a blind eye. And the individuals that perpetrate these crimes are often very wealthy. So they might bring even resources into those countries and be allowed to live sort of undisturbed, either because the country is not concerned for political reasons or it's just not very effectively governed, which happens in many cases as well. So that's what I mean by a horizontal system, whereby states can cooperate with each other, and it's critically important. In the terrorism cases, the U.S. likes to militarize terrorism cases, but the most effective weapons, right, are the Convention on Terrorist Financing, is seizing bank accounts and shutting down the flow of money and making it impossible for people to actually go from place to place or transfer their money from place to place to buy weaponry. And that is all done by international treaty. All of that is treaty rule. It is not customary international law. There's a teeny piece the Security Council likes to do by itself, but that's another subject, right? And you've got to have the treaties in place. And in a way, it's almost astonishing that we could have hundreds of international criminal law conventions that do this for money laundering and drug trafficking and human trafficking and organized crime that don't do it for crimes against humanity, right? So when I started our conference in Geneva, I said, folks, I really want you to think, shouldn't our presumption be the opposite? It's not should we do this, it's why haven't we done this? Why haven't we put this most important crime, which involves the commission of terrible atrocities, into a convention? So thank you. Another great question.
I noticed that, I guess as you were speaking, one of the things I was thinking about was, I guess as a person who's not a lawyer, thinking that you've been talking about prosecuting individuals, and I guess I'm thinking about the idea of you're not punishing the state that does the crime, you're punishing the individuals. But when I think of crime, that we prosecute the individual, not the nation. And I'm kind of wondering, you know, I guess that makes me just ask, what does, when you talk about crimes against individuals perpetrated by states, what does that mean?
Such a great question. Wow. I get some teaching of international law. It's great theory. So there are two components in, well, let me, a little history. Again, going back to World War I, the thought was, we'll prosecute the Kaiser. Because remember, this is the second time. There's the 1870 Prussian invasion, right? Anybody who's read David McCulloch's beautiful book on Americans in Paris will know that World War I was actually the second war, right? And because there was the 1870 invasion. And so the French are pretty upset about this, right? Paris keeps getting invaded. Or at least France keeps getting invaded, or they're having problems with their German neighbors. And so the idea was, well, instead of, after World War I, we're going to impose reparations. Germany's going to have to pay reparations because the state is responsible. But there's also this outrage at the leader, right? That the Kaiser is actually ordering all these things, and you have this huge loss of life, right? Mostly soldiers, World War I, but huge loss of life. very, very bloody, horrible war. And so World War II then happens. World War I was the great war, right? It was the war to end all wars, and it didn't. So World War II happens, and folks start saying, okay, we gotta do something different, because our treaties that are trying to say you have to pay reparations as a state if you wage war against your neighbors, which is what we told Germany, actually backfired because it impoverishes Germany. And I know that some of the historians now argue Margaret Macmillan has sort of a different thesis, but I think it's generally accepted that the collective reparations impoverished Germany, which then gave rise to National Socialism of Hitler and sort of provided a fertile field for Hitler's rise to power. And so that's when Nuremberg comes in and says, we are not going to collectively punish the entire German people. We are going to punish those most responsible for perpetrating these atrocities, for waging the war, managing the atrocities, for designing the system of total war, etc. And so that was a revolutionary idea, that you would really have individual criminal responsibility. But states are still behind the effort, right? So what our proposal has is this notion of state responsibility, which is not criminal responsibility. It's not saying you're a pathological being who has committed an atrocity. It's saying the state's apparatus, the government, that state has committed a, quote, internationally wrongful act. And that should be compensable. Now, in Bosnia versus Serbia, the ICJ did not award reparations. But the notion of state responsibility is that when states harm other states, they should have to repair the damage. And there are various doctrines on how they should have to repair the damage. That's a state to state. And the reason that we said no reservations is we want something in this treaty to allow states to sue each other. Maybe before the International Court of Justice, put a compromissory clause saying this state is alleged to have committed a crime against humanity against our state and should be held accountable in a court of law. So there are two distinct branches, but the state part of it now is civil or it's not criminal, and then we think of the individuals as criminal. And there is a whole theory about that. I mean, goes back to the other question. We see the behavior when atrocities are committed as pathological behavior that should be treated by the criminal law. And that's why the push for prosecutions in those cases. But it doesn't leave aside the fact that the state's money, power, and resources were being used to injure the citizens potentially of another state. And so in an interstate context, that could be another grounds for responsibility. But it's not criminal. They don't go to jail. You can't put a state in jail. But you can put, right, perpetrators of atrocities in jail. And that's the idea. It's putting real people in real jails. And that's a very unusual thing for international law to do.
Well, I think we are out of time. So if you would just join me in thanking Lyle for a really wonderful presentation.